Hello and welcome to Business on the Wire. It's a statistic that is casually thrown in many conversations with people from the business community, often saying, oh, 95% of startups fail. Perhaps that's true, and there certainly have been more that have decided to close rather than hold on. But do you ever read about them or hear about them? The ones that grab headlines and top interview slots on TV channels are the glittering successes, the unicorns, the apple of the startup world's eyes. In fact, let's step away from startups or business for a minute and talk about mental health itself. A Lancet study published in 2020 reports that 1 in 7 Indians were affected by mental disorders of varying severity in 2017. The proportional contribution of mental disorders to the total disease burden in India has actually doubled since 1990. Now shift that prism to running a business. Probably one of the most difficult, challenging, and mentally taxing endeavors a man or a woman can undertake. COVID has ravaged young businesses, forcing entrepreneurs to take extremely difficult decisions, like shutting parts of their business down, laying off employees, or even closing down their enterprise altogether. A recent study by the University of San Francisco focused on the mental health crisis that seems to be raging amongst men and women of the American entrepreneurial community. And here's what they found. According to that study, approximately one half, that's 49% of entrepreneurs in the US, suffer from at least one form of a mental health condition during their lifetime. That could include ADHD, bipolar disorder, a host of addictive disorders. While entrepreneurship by its very nature is a lonely and intense world, how has COVID been different from challenges they faced before? I spoke with entrepreneurs from varied backgrounds, and here's what came through. While the struggles are personal, the common thread is the feeling that you are in this alone.
Very different. And the journey of an entrepreneur is full of struggles, but it's also exciting and rewarding at the same time. You know, it's safe to say that we can divide the world into two parts. One is pre-COVID and the other is post-COVID. Pre-COVID, the kind of challenges we had were, customer acquisition, business development, looking at people management, having constant look at the bottom line. And of course, the industry that we're in, which is about product and experiences, constantly creating products for our existing target base. So these were the kind of challenges that we faced every day, and we really thrived in that. Post-COVID, it's all about survival. For a lot of small and medium enterprises like ourselves, we've taken certain tough decisions about cost cutting and downsizing, and it's particularly hard because you're downsizing people who've been a very, very integral part of your growth. But the idea is to survive this time, and when things pick up, probably hire the same talent back. The second struggle for a company like ours that gives an on-field experience is having no work, which means there is no interaction with the guests. It's sometimes hard to keep the team motivated in the travel industry because you don't know what the distant future looks like for travel. But to create an environment, and that is something that we're constantly learning as entrepreneurs, to keep an environment that's conducive, that's motivating for the team to know that things will survive, things will get better, and when it is, we'll be ready to face any challenges that come forth. Not just face those challenges, but also thrive. And I think these are the challenges that at this point of time we are facing as entrepreneurs.
The biggest challenge has been cash flow. As COVID started to hit and the country went into a lockdown, every other business also shut down, and as a result of which businesses stopped. The entire machinery, the entire engine stopped working, and so there was no cash flow. And in that, in particularly in that scenario, we've still got to maintain a team. We've still got to keep the team committed. We've still got to keep vendors' payments. We've got to make the vendors' payments. With no money coming in, with no cash coming in. So that was probably the biggest challenge that any entrepreneurs faced, and so have we.
In terms of mental health, specifically for women and women entrepreneurs, I've seen, you know, most women rise in crisis, and we've seen this play itself out in, you know, whether it's leadership in countries, economies, wherever there is a woman leader, the way they've dealt with COVID has been, you know, dramatically different from when it's dealt with by a male leader. So I think in crisis, the sense of calm that a woman brings is possibly a big advantage during these times, something that we as women don't acknowledge as actively. But our ability to multitask and put things up in the air is incredibly high. But by the same measure, reaching out for help and seeking out help is incredibly low. So the focus of, you know, at least through all my conversations with colleagues and with other women entrepreneurs, it's really about saying, how do you take those baby steps? Put on your oxygen mask before you support others. How do you take care of yourself? And focus on that. You know, if you're strong in a household, the household thrives. If you're strong in a business, and you're mentally and physically strong, the business thrives.
So what's the India story here? To understand what the mental health picture in India actually looks like, I spoke with Dr. Amit Malik. He's co-founder and CEO at InnerR, an app that works to deliver mental health care through technology. He's straddling both worlds, really.
Okay, so I want to start with a more personal question for you. One of the last few months have been for you as an entrepreneur.
I think it's been an interesting last 3 or 4 months now, really. So it all happened very quickly. So we had to adapt quickly, and two or three things happened for us so NLR is a mental health platform. We provide digital solutions for mental health and work with individuals and organizations across the country. Right, so we work with a large number of organizations, but also over 6 lakh lives across 100 different cities that we work with, and then we have therapists providing therapy in about 8 different languages, and a large network of over 150 therapists that work with us in that journey. Along with our self-care tool, which is used daily by about 10 to 12,000 people, right? So that's kind of what we do, right? And so when the pandemic hit, there were impacts at multiple levels, right? So A, it impacted us and our employees individually. And so we very, very quickly had to go into a lockdown scenario like everybody else in the country and figure out work from home for ourselves and as for our teams. And so we did that. We did that pretty quickly, I think. And that journey has been, I think, quite developmental for all of us in terms of being able to adapt to new working and personal environments. I think it took us maybe 2 or 3 weeks to get it right, but I think we got there quickly. Then the whole how the dynamic changed in the external world around the expressed need for mental health, along with what we started to see in terms of the actual need turning into demand, where people were actually calling in and saying, how can we get help, right? So what we did very early on was took a conscious decision that we want to help as much as we can, right? So whilst we are a for-profit business, we also took a very conscious decision to say we want to help as much as we possibly can, and help at least 2 or 3 specific categories and give more focused support. So one was really healthcare workers, right, and frontline healthcare workers and what we could do for them. The second was employees working from home, right, because we already had that work stream. We thought we could expand that. And so what we did was we put out a whole bunch of pro bono programs for organizations that were either employing work from home employees or hospital and other organizations that employ frontline healthcare workers. And we made the entire offering free, right? So we made the entire offering free. So we had a significant uptick of organizations. We now are working with 60 or 70 organizations now that have all come on board in the last 3 months. And in terms of our pro bono program, whether it's our access to our webinars, whether it's access to our content, access to the self-care tools, which are usually paid but are now been made available for free. So all these things we saw a big uptick on. And that really has obviously had an impact on our workload and what we have to do. And the team has coped admirably well with it. So we've been able to ramp up supply at our end, but also then been able to give people that support that they need. We got into a groove. It took us about 2-3 weeks to get into a groove of communication, right? The first 2-3 weeks of communication within the team were hard. And then we got into sorting out processes around how to communicate well within teams, with each other as individuals, how to use channels like Slack and WhatsApp more effectively, how to use Zoom more judiciously and not be on video calls most of the time. So it took us a few weeks to understand that, and then you know we've been having regular town halls and team meetings and sort of daily stand-ups with the leadership team to really look at how things are on a day-to-day basis. So I think we've adapted to the new normal at a structural perspective. For us, it's been also the new normal from a demand perspective. So it's been a combination of those two things together. So I think that's kind of how we've been doing. And on a personal level, I decided, I think after a couple of weeks, that I don't know how long this is going to carry on. So something good has to come out of it. So I hit the treadmill and I'm now 10% lighter than I was at the beginning of the lockdown, and physically healthier than I ever was. So yeah, so it's been good to have a physical health focus and a mental health focus to be able to get through the period, essentially.
Yeah, good on you. I don't know how many people can claim to be 10% lighter after this entire period. But, you know, I want to take a step back, Amit, and just sort of focus on the vertical or the prism that we're looking at this situation from, and whether there are actually any numbers to, you know, to even set some kind of framework in. I was looking at a World Economic Forum report that then quoted a University of San Francisco study, which pointed out that close to 49%, and they believe this was a conservative estimate, of male and female entrepreneurs were suffering from some kind of mental health challenge, whether it was anxiety disorders or substance abuse or ADHD. There was something that they were struggling with, and it had a lot to do with the path, the professional path they had chosen. Now, first of all, do we have any such data out there in India, or is it anecdotal? And secondly, would you agree with a figure like that? Do you think that's a fair estimate?
Short answer to your first question, I don't think we have India-specific data for that. Not that I've seen anyways. But anecdotally, it seems correct. And then let's take a step back and see why, right? India itself, at a global level, has 197 million people with mental illness. Right, so pre-COVID, pre-pandemic, they're literally saying about 197 million people out of 1.2 million, which is about 1/6 of the
population. So Amit, Lancet says that 1 in 7 Indians are affected by mental disorders. That's the figure we're looking
at. About right, yeah. So this is Lancet study from a couple of years ago that's talking about this 197 million number as well, I think, if I'm quoting it correctly. And if you think about that, that's roughly about 1 in 6 point something, 1 in 7 roughly, that's the number, right? So that's kind of what we're starting with. General population pre-pandemic, right? So that's kind of what we're starting. Now we look at some Indian stats around workplace stress and workplace emotional difficulties. That number goes up to 45 to 46%, and there's some studies that have been done by industry and trade bodies that show that number is around 45-46% in all employees, again pre-pandemic, pre-COVID, right? So this is again more a general health number. Now you then say, okay, there are some stats that have been quoted in the recent past where in pandemics, during and post, we see an uptick in mental health needs of the population by about 4 or 5 times.
Okay.
Right. So that's what these are some of these broad studies that we're talking about. And so now when you put all those three numbers together, the founder number definitely seems low, right? So because let's look at the founder context that we're talking about, right? So we are talking about people living in the best of times, living with a huge amount of uncertainty, a huge degree of at least sense of responsibility, not real responsibility, right? For the organizations they've started, for the employees they have to pay salaries to, for the customers they're looking to serve to, and for the investors they're taking money from. So for all those segments, a huge sense of responsibility that comes along with being a founder, right? So all of these, at the best of times, create a degree of uncertainty, a degree of stress that is over and above what a benchmark employee stress would be, right? And then you take the current context in which everything got hit, right? So you are having to look at revenue numbers in a very different way, right? Because the pre-COVID scenario doesn't exist for you anymore. You're having to look at costs in a different way, because if you're back at office, then you have sort of additional costs of managing distancing and additional costs of managing workplace safety or employee travel, if that might be the concern. And if you're not working from back at the office, then the challenge of managing work more effectively whilst keeping your employee well-being, motivation and morale up are all sort of additional costs. So the revenue side is hit, the cost side is hit, and there's a medium to long-term uncertainty that goes along with it. Yeah. Right, so most founders I know and speak to within the network are working 1.5 times as hard as they have before, regardless of how their business is doing. Right, if it's doing well, then they're having to work harder anyways. If they're not doing well, they're having to work harder. So regardless of what the business context is, what the vertical is that they're operating in, which might have differential impact, maybe differentially impacted by the pandemic, they're working harder, right? So, and what hard work does, it's a great thing to work hard, but what hard work does is it reduces your reserves, because you sleep less, eat don't eat well, and then you are less resilient to be able to face these challenges. So I completely buy that number, and I agree that it's probably higher than...
I mean, you're right. I spoke to some entrepreneurs already anecdotally, and I think the one point that came through to me was that they felt it was 24/7. There are no boundaries now between work and home. You know, is that a challenge particular to people who run their own businesses? Because I think everyone's feeling it, but they probably feel it more than that.
So as I said, you know, we're working with a large number of organizations, right? And work from home challenges are one of the big things that are coming up, right? So two things that have come up, or two or three things that have come up significantly in the last few weeks, sort of themes within the employee population. One is work from home, and then the challenges around and work-life boundaries, and I'll talk a bit more to that in a second. The second, relationship difficulties have sort of become intensified, where people have, you know, imagine this scenario, you don't get along with your spouse or your parent, and suddenly you're trapped in the same environment for 4 months with each other. That's a recipe for lots of challenges, right? And so that's really kept up. And the third is around issues around health-related anxieties, around obsessive behavior around health. All those things are the third issue that's creeping up, right? So that's the three big issues. And then there are the things like survivor guilt and things that are also creeping up in the scenario. But talking about the one you picked on, which is work from home, the idea of the artificial boundaries that going to office and coming back creates has completely dissipated, right? This is my space, and this is my workspace, and this is my personal space. Now that boundary is totally gone, right? And so, and it's hard for founders, but it's, but I feel it's harder for other employees more than founders, because founders still have some semblance of control as to when they can maintain the boundaries, and some of them are using that. But employees are having a bigger challenge, because sometimes they don't have that control of being asked to do things on a weekend or later 10 o'clock on a Thursday night. So it's very, very critical for both for individual morale, for your long-term retention of your employees, but also for your overall productivity of the business, that you create those boundaries. We had to do some work in the beginning. So what happened in the beginning for us was that people just started setting calls up at 8 o'clock at night and routine calls, and you realize that actually suddenly all the boundaries were getting disappeared, and it was beginning to show with the team. And so we sort of had to put some guardrails in place, saying that it has to be something urgent that came up just now for you to have a conversation with a team member after 7:30 in the evening, right? So that has to, and same applies to weekends. And so try to create some sacrosanct time, because, you know, what's happened is that whilst we might believe that it's easier because we're not going out and we don't have to travel and the commute time has gone away, especially in a city like Bombay, but what also is happening is you have more responsibilities at home, right? You are having to get your groceries and sanitize them, and deliveries are not coming to the house. You have to go get stuff from outside, and a lot of us who have children have childcare responsibilities along with work responsibilities, which the school was shouldering a big part of, and not right now. And so all those things are adding to sort of various sort of work-life balance pressures. And it's very, very important to step back and recognize that. And founders are not immune to it.
You mentioned that you have seen a spike in terms of, you know, because of the nature of your work, a lot more people are probably reaching out for some kind of help. Within that, would you say there is a large chunk of the entrepreneurial community that is reaching out actively to get help? Because sometimes the problem also is this image of being a superhero, a superwoman, you know, I can handle it all. I've seen it. This is what being an entrepreneur is. I got to keep going.
So very transparently, we don't track the data, and if we did, we wouldn't share it. But anecdotally, the answer is yes, right? And that image is a big problem, right? That image management that founders believe they really have to do, right? This is a huge part of the problem, and the whole concept of make it till you fake it, or you know, that just creates a degree of a self-fulfilling prophecy. What it does is, in the best of times, what it does is, if you keep pretending that you're good and successful, eventually you'll get there. But what it also does is it starts creating an image and a persona of yourself that you then have to constantly live with and justify. And then you start feeling that there's a degree of imposter syndrome, where even when you get to being good, then you don't really believe that you're actually good. So it's whilst it's been propagated for a long time, the idea of, you know, keep going and keep making it till you faking it till you make it, it actually has some longer term impacts. And founders, especially single founder companies, feel a lot of pressure to really internalize that rather than share it with the team. and really absorb all the stress rather than having, thinking of the collective team effort often. And that is not a really healthy long-term strategy that can work even at the best of times, let alone now. So completely. And I think the other thing that is really coming out to the fore with that ecosystem is the lack of organized peer support structures.
Yeah.
Because what really helps is that being able to talk to somebody who's at a similar stage as yours or has been through a similar stage as yours in not so recent past. And so they can help normalize some of these things to you, right? So it's normal that this happens. It's normal that you have a dip in customers after 3 months or so, whatever it might be, right? So normalizing some of those things that happen for a founder so that some of the stressors around it can go down. And that has really come to the fore now that India especially lacks formal ecosystems of peer support for founders, which exist in more advanced startup ecosystems, like whether it's the Valley or whether it's in London. That's missing here, essentially.
Yeah. How do you sort of set out the first few markers where you know that you should reach out and talk to someone? I mean, whether it is a mental health professional or a friend, Amit, because of the nature of this, I mean, what, 8% of the world's population is an entrepreneur, so I guess that's the reason it's a small percentage. How do you know when this is different from what you've been struggling with before and it's time to talk to someone?
I think there are some broad markers, right? I won't go into signs and symptoms right now because then it becomes too technical. But there are some broad markers, right? So if you say you've been experiencing this stress consistently over a period of time, maybe 2 weeks or so, right? So that's one marker. You're unable to enjoy things that you used to, right? You struggle to go about day-to-day tasks, right? It's becoming difficult, becoming a chore, it's becoming a struggle to do that. And you're unable to cope despite using the best coping techniques, right? And things like enjoyment has become more diminished. You don't enjoy things as much, you're more easily irritable, your eating and sleeping patterns are off, and otherwise physically you're healthy, then it's time to think about, do I need more help, right? Do I need more help in terms of it going and talking to somebody or using some self-care strategies, right? Most people are very, very ambivalent. When we first started NRR, we spoke to over 1 lakh people with some degree of psychological distress in India, and we learned that most people are very ambivalent to go and see a professional straight away. But and people really, what really people want is some structured, scientific, strategic self-help solutions as a first starting point, right? Which is the whole genesis of our app, essentially. Right. So accessing some self-care tools as a first step, and then realizing that things are not getting better, then accessing a professional is the next step. Right. Is those are signs to look out for, essentially.
In the next episode, we hear from entrepreneurs on how work and livelihoods have been hit by the COVID pandemic, and also what helps when you're faced with a challenge like this.